Well, friends, welcome to today's class. Previous class, we are learning about the legal aspects of audit, isn't it? So that is one of the very important aspect in the context of company accounts. I am going to share the screen with you. Just wait a minute. I think you are able to see the screen. Just confirm me if screen is visible. Please confirm me if screen is visible.
Sir, yes, clearly sir. Visible.
Okay, clearly fine. Visible.
Fine. Yeah, so we are discussing about the chapter 10 of the Companies Act 2013, various aspects relating to the audit, legal aspects relating to audit. We were discussing in our previous class. In that context, we are talking about qualifications of an auditor. So we have understood that thing. And you had a question that what is the meaning of body corporate? I told you that we'll be verifying it from the definition part, which is provided in the Companies Act. Right, when you know, and earlier we are discussing that a body corporate cannot be appointed as the auditor of the company, right? Okay, except LLP. LLP can be appointed as an auditor of the company, right? If majority of the majority of the partners are chartered accountants, but a body corporate cannot be appointed. And you wanted to know what is the definition of the body corporate. So let me tell you, this is the definition of the body corporate as provided in the Companies Act 2013. Section 2, Clause 11 provides the definition. It includes a company incorporated outside India. Okay. Includes. You see, this is an inclusive definition. That means there is a possibility that there might be some other kinds of body corporates also. Okay. Specifically, the definition says it includes. So, you can say any company can be a body corporate, including the companies which are incorporated outside India. But it doesn't include cooperative society. Cooperative society is not a body corporate under Companies Act 2013. And also one more thing, central government may decide, central government may specify that a particular organization can be treated as a body corporate or cannot be treated as a body corporate. So this is the definition of the body corporate. Okay, we have understood. And these body corporates cannot be appointed as an auditor. And we have seen some of the disqualifications that if a person is holding a security, then holding a security at the company, he cannot be appointed as an auditor. But however, securities can be held in the name of the relatives for a face value not exceeding 1 lakh rupees. That's the thing we have understood. Okay, if the person is indebted in excess of 5 lakh rupees, he also cannot be appointed as the auditor. If the person has provided guarantee or some security in excess of 1 lakh rupees, he cannot be appointed as an auditor. So these are some major disqualifications. Other disqualifications, all these things we had discussed in our previous class. Right. So, and therefore, purposefully, I'm skipping this slide. Straight away, I'll go to the appointment process. Yeah, coming to this appointment process, in the previous class, we are discussing this thing. Okay, various sections subsections are involved. So this I will be just telling you in a summarized form how auditors are appointed. First question comes about the first auditor, when the company is formed, how the first auditor is appointed. Right. So in case it is a non-government company, other than a government company, appointments are made under section 139. And the provision is that first auditor will be appointed by board of directors. Okay, are you seeing it? Who will appoint the first auditor? Who will be appointing the board of directors, right? Within 30 days from the date of registration, once the company is registered, within 30 days, board of directors are supposed to appoint the director. And in case they fail to appoint, then the members of the company can call an extraordinary general meeting and appoint an auditor within 90 days. Okay, within 90 days, auditors can be appointed by members in an each. This is about non-government company or a company other than government company. But government company procedures are slightly different. In government company, how appointments will happen? Appointments are made by C&AG within 60 days from the date of registration. Right? Once the company is registered, within 60 days, who will appoint it? Who will make the appointment of government auditors?
Comptroller and auditors. Good evening, sir.
Very good evening. So, we are continuing the discussion.
There was some issue in joining. Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, so we have just started. You see, this in case of government company, appointments will be made by the Comptroller and Auditor General of India within 60 days from the date of registration. And in case C&AG fails, then Board of Directors of the company can appoint auditor within next 30 days. If Board of Directors also fail to make appointment within next 30 days, then the members of the company can call an extraordinary general meeting, and within 60 days, first auditor can be appointed. Okay, we are here, we are talking about the first auditor of the company when the company gets incorporated. And that auditor, when he is appointed from the date of appointment, he holds the office till the conclusion of the first annual general meeting. Once the annual general meeting is over, this auditor's office will be over. Okay, now new auditors will be appointed. We will be calling those auditors as subsequent auditors. Okay, now let us see the procedure for appointment of these subsequent auditors. Here also procedures are different for government company and for other than government company. For other than government company, all the subsequent auditors are appointed in a general meeting. And when appointed, they hold the office from that AGM till the conclusion of the next 6th AGM. That means the appointment is for a period of 5 years. Okay. And in case of government company, appointment has to be made by C&AG every year within 180 days from the commencement of the year. So we have understood for other than government company, appointment is for 5 years. And for government company, appointment is made every year within 180 days from the commencement of the year. Year commences on 1st April, so within 180 days, auditor needs to be appointed. And that auditor holds the office till the conclusion of AGM. That means here appointment is for 1 year in case of government company for all subsequent auditors. Okay, detailed procedure of appointment, etc., we are not covering, in fact, keeping in mind the content of our syllabus. So only at a very basic level, we are covering regarding appointment of the auditors. Next concept we need to understand. Appointment of auditors is over. Have you understood it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now we'll switch over to one more area. This is about the removal of the auditor. Now question comes whether auditor who is appointed once can be removed. Answer is yes. Auditor can be removed before expiry of his office, before expiry of his terms in the office. How they can be removed? By special resolution. You know what is a special resolution? Right, so at least 3/4 majority is required. So votes cast in favor of the resolution must exceed 3 times of the vote cast against the resolution, if any. So a special resolution is required. And after obtaining the previous approval of the central government. So two issues are there. First of all, previous approval of the central government is required. Secondly, special resolution is required. So it is not that easy to remove an auditor. You have to obtain this previous approval of the central government and also has to pass a special resolution. And one more condition or one more compliance is required, that an opportunity of being heard must be given to that auditor. Right? A reasonable opportunity of being heard must be given to the auditor. So auditor has got a right to explain the reasons. Okay. Reasons for not removing him from the office of the auditor. Okay, so all these 3 things are required. Opportunity of being heard must be given. Previous approval of the central government must have been taken. And the special resolution must have been passed. Only when these 3 things or 3 issues are complied with, then only one can remove the auditor. Understood? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So auditor's removal is possible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, friend, how to remove an application, how to remove an auditor, how to make an application to the central government. This is the format. Okay, this form is provided in the rules that in this particular form, application has to be made by the central government, made to the central government, and central government may give approval. Okay, this is the content of that application. Now, next concept is about resignation of the auditor. One thing is appointment we have understood. Removal also we have understood. Now we're coming to resignation. Auditor has got a right to resign from his office. Okay. But once he resigns, auditor decides to resign, or in case he has resigned, then he is supposed to file within 30 days from the date of his registration, a statement in a prescribed form with the ROC. So with the registrar of the company, one statement needs to be filed within 30 days of his resignation. Right. In case of government companies, such statements shall also be filed with C&AG, with the Controller and Auditor General of India. This statement also has to be filed. And that statement should indicate the reasons and other facts of resignation. Why the auditor has resigned, what is the reason, and any other fact that the auditor wants to communicate, those things should be there in the statement. Right? This is how resignation of the auditor can be made. This is the form.
He has to cite the reasons. He has to cite the reasons of resignation.
Yes, he has to. Yeah, within 30 days, he has to submit a statement. And the statement should contain the reasons and other factors. Okay, and this is the form to which auditor files with the ROC. This is the form which auditor files with the ROC regarding the notice of resignation of the auditor. Okay, this form is called as ADT3. This is also filed electronically. Auditor finds all this thing. Who is the auditor, etc. Okay, you see. Any other fact relevant to the resignation, you see whether resignation is attached, auditor may attach the resignation. Here you see one point, reason of resignation. Why the auditor has resigned, this can be mentioned here. Any other fact relevant for the resignation, that also can be mentioned here. Finally, the form will be verified and digitally signed, and it will be electronically submitted to the ROC. This is the form. Okay.
Sir, section of resignation of what, sir? 140.
140. Right. Okay. In the beginning of the slide, if you see, there is a list of sections you can refer to. Now, coming to one more aspect, that is the remuneration of the auditor. Okay, the remuneration of the auditor of a company shall be fixed at the general meeting or in such manner as may be determined therein. It may be fixed at the general meeting or general meeting, it may be decided in which manner remuneration can be decided. Okay, provided that the board may fix the remuneration for the first auditor appointed by it. First auditor, you know, is appointed by board of directors. Board may fix remuneration for the first auditor. For other auditors, for the subsequent auditors, the remuneration is to be fixed at the general meeting. Okay. A remuneration in addition to fees payable to an auditor includes the expenses, if any, incurred by the auditor in connection with the audit of the company and any other facility extended to him. If some expenditures are reimbursed to the auditor, which is incurred by the auditor, reimbursed by the company, or any other facilities extended to the auditor, that will also constitute as a remuneration. Right? But however, it does not include any remuneration paid to him for any other services. If auditor has performing some other services, some other allowable services, not as an auditor, for some other thing it has provided, that will not be considered as a remuneration. Okay. And you know, the Companies Act has got a Schedule 3. Schedule 3 talks about the format of financial statements, and there, as per the notes given in the Schedule 3 or the as per the general instructions provided in the Schedule 3 to the Companies Act 2013, company in its financial statement should disclose payments made to the auditor as under. That means in this particular way, if you see, any payments made to the auditor has to be disclosed in this manner. That means payments made to the auditor as auditor for tax matters, for company law matters, for management services, for other services, for reimbursement of expenses. right? Totally, how much has been made, how much payment has been made, component wise, all these things needs to be disclosed in the company's financial statement. Okay, suppose auditor is also handling taxes and matter. So how much fees has been paid as his audit fee? How much fee is paid for the taxes and matter? Let us say he is also the income tax auditor. For taxes and matter, how much is the fee? How much fee is paid for company law matters? How much fee is paid for management services or for any other services, for reimbursement or expenditure? Everything has to be disclosed in this manner. Understood? Okay.
These expenses are all regarding for auditor.
Yeah, this is whatever payment is made to the auditor, it has to be disclosed in this way.
In different heads, in taxation, in company, in management, in other.
Yeah. Here you see, practically I am showing you one financial statement. It is a particular, it's a note attached to the financial statement. You see, this company has disclosed how much payment is made to auditor. As auditor for taxation matters, for company law matters, for reimbursement of expenses. Okay, everything company has disclosed. Right? So this is how disclosure needs to be made. Okay then? Now we'll be covering one more aspect regarding powers and rights of auditors. Several sections are involved. So we'll not go by section wise. We'll not just make a list out. We'll just listing out what are the powers and rights of the auditor. First right is that auditor has got a right to access books and other documents. Okay. At any time. So at any time, auditor has always got a right to access to the books of accounts and other documents. Right. Financial books and non-financial books also, auditor has got that right. During business hours, auditor can ask for these books of accounts. Right to obtain information and explanation from the officers. And also, he has got a right to inquire into certain matters. Third right is right to receive notices to attend general meeting. So all notices of general meeting has also to be sent to the auditor. Auditor has got a right to receive notice and to attend the general meeting. Right to report members of the company on the accounts examined by him. So auditor submits an audit report where he reports to the members of the company. Right to lien on the documents which came to his possession under authority of the client for non-payment of fees. If fees are not paid and some document has come to auditor under the authority of the client, auditor has got a right to keep that document as a lien. That means as a security, auditor can keep that document. Okay. For non-submission of and for non-payment of his fees. So this is the summary of various rights that the auditor has. Are you clear on this?
The auditor can keep the documents on lien.
Yeah.
Sir, without lien, he can also keep, no, sir. He has done auditing, means he can have a copy, no, sir.
No, that should come under the authority of the client. Client should officially submit you. Suppose client is submitting you the cash book. Okay, you can retain that cash book.
Oh,
okay.
Okay.
But it has to come under authority of the client. But you cannot just like that as an auditor just like that cannot pick up the cash book of the client. If it has come to him under authority of the client, then auditor can keep that document. Okay.
Yes.
That right auditor has. So Companies Act provides these kind of rights. But here the requirement is that the records should come under
authority. Sir, one point, sir, for non-payment of fees. Suppose the client didn't pay the fee.
Yeah.
Then he can keep the cash book on lien, sir.
Auditor. Yeah, he can keep it. He can keep it provided cash book has come to him under authority of the client.
Sir.
If client has handed over the cash book, then he can keep it for non-payment of fees.
Sir.
Okay.
Sir.
Is it clear?
Clear, sir.
Okay. These are legal rights, so there should not be any confusion here. Now, coming to duties of the auditor, duty to inquire on certain matters. So, certain matters auditor needs to inquire. We will not venture detail into that. in the process of auditing, auditor conducts several inquiries. He has to sign the audit report. This is also his duty. Duty to comply with auditing standards. While conducting the audit, he has to comply with the auditing standards. And as per the prescribed standard, he has to do the audit. Duty to issue audit report. Once audit is done, he has to issue the report. That's also his duty. Duty to report on frauds. If some frauds are found, auditor finds that fraud has been committed or is being committed, he is supposed to give a report on this. Okay, not only to the company, but also to the central government also. This report has to be made. Duty to report any other matter specified by central government. Central government from time to time gives order to report some specific things, and those specific things needs to be reported. That is also duty of the auditor. Duty to deal with branch audit reports. So branch auditors are there, companies branch auditors are there. They submit report to the chief auditor or the central auditor. And it's the duty of the auditor to consider and deal with this branch audit report. Duty to state reasons for qualifications or negative report. If auditor bring some kind of qualification in the report or give some kind of negative report, then it is auditor's duty to state the reasons why he has qualified the report or why he has given this negative report. He has to give the reasons. So these are the duties of auditor. Understood?
Understood, sir.
Okay. So rights and duties we had covered. Right. Here one more requirement in the process of auditing is there. You know, in certain situation, auditor is duty bound to directly report to the central government. In which situation, if auditor has reason to believe an offense involving fraud is being or has been committed, so auditor has enough reason to believe that there is an offense involving fraud which has already been committed or it is being committed against the company by officers or employees of the company. Some officers, some employees of the company are committing the fraud or have already committed the fraud. Then what is his responsibility? He shall immediately report the matter to the central government. Okay. It has to be reported directly to the central government. Okay. Within such time, in such manner as may be prescribed. So this is one additional power that auditor always has. This is his professional power. And I'll be telling you within how much time and how this has to be reported. Okay, to understand that the time frame and the reporting process, we have to refer to the company's audit and auditor's rule, to the auditor's rule. And the rule number 13, rule 13 specifies how this has to be reported. So this fraud incident has to be reported to the central government immediately, but not later than 60 days from his knowledge. The moment it comes to the auditor's knowledge that fraud has been committed or fraud is being committed by the officers or employees of the company, as soon as possible, auditor needs to communicate it to the central government, but not later than 60 days. So max period is 60 days. Within 60 days, he is supposed to communicate it. How he will be communicating? Auditor is also required to forward his report to the board of directors or the audit committee. So this reports that the fraud has been committed, this fraud report has to be submitted to the board of directors or audit committee immediately after it comes to his knowledge and seeking their reply within 45 days. So auditor should immediately communicate to the board and seek their reply within 45 days. If they give reply, then along with the reply within remaining 15 days, total 60 days is allowed. Within 60 days, auditor is supposed to report to the central government. So, if the board of director or audit committee gives a reply within 45 days, then along with the reply, he has to submit the report to the central government. If they do not give any reply also, so auditor has to state the fact that reply has not been received and he has to submit the report to the central government. Understood the process?
Sir.
Okay.
Central government means to whom, sir? CAG.
I'll be showing you the exact address to where it has to be sent. Okay. Not CAG, it is to central government. I'll be showing you the exact address. Okay, just wait a minute. The next slide it will be coming.
Sir.
Right. So on receipt of the reply of the observation, suppose auditor's observation is replied by the board or replied by the audit committee, then auditor has to submit that reply also within 15 days. In addition to his report, within 15 days, he has to submit it. If auditor fails to get such reply of the observation, then auditor needs to forward his report with a note containing the details of his report and also the fact that board has not given any reply or he has failed to receive any reply from the observations within the stipulated time. That means within 45 days, no reply has been received. That fact also needs to be communicated to the central committee. Now, your question that where it should go, this report, what is the exact address? Central government means what? Central government means the report should be sent to this address. Can you read it? Some of you can. Please read it.
Ministry
of Corporate Affairs in a sealed cover by registered post with acknowledgement due or by speed post followed by an email in confirmation of the same. This is the process. Okay, so it has to go to the Secretary of Ministry of Corporate Affairs. The report shall be made on the letterhead of the auditor containing his postal address, email address and contact number. Should be signed by the auditor with his seal and shall indicate his membership number. So this is the complete format in which report has to be made. So in a particular form that report has to be made, I will be showing you that form very shortly. IDT-4. Right. Okay, so let me show you. This is the IDT-4, you see. This is how report to the central government has to be made. Right, you see these points, the basis on which fraud is suspected, period during which the suspected fraud was occurred. So like this, all this information needs to be submitted. Date of sending report to the board or audit committee, date of reply received, whether auditor is satisfied with the reply, all this information should be provided to the central government. Okay. Right. And similar provisions are applicable to the cost auditors also. Cost auditor, even in certain situations or certain class of companies, cost audit is also applicable. If it is applicable and the cost auditor also finds similar kind of fraud is from similar kind of fraud, it can also report to the central government adopting a similar kind of procedure. Okay. Now, this is about reporting requirements. Now, friends, quickly we'll be covering.
Cost auditor is different, sir.
Cost auditor is different. We are, in fact, not covering cost audit now. We are covering only statutory audit. Okay. One thing we have understood. Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, this auditor. Yeah. Without informing the board of directors or MD chairman, he sends directly the report to central government, sir. Okay. Cover.
Mm-hmm. Without informing, no, he has to inform. He has to inform to the board, then he will send. He has to inform to the board and ask for board's reply. And board's reply is expected within 45 days. If it doesn't receive, then he should directly forward it, indicating that board has not replied. But board reply is required.
Sir, basically you are doing just statutory auditing, sir.
Yeah, we are covering statutory. Not?
Cost auditing.
No, not cost audit. You see, we see different kinds of audits in the context of companies. So many audits are there. But when you talk about the statutory audits, now when you talk about the audit, generally, we say the audit of a company will refer to statutory auditor. Okay. Otherwise, company has several kinds of audit. Company has cost audit. Company has secretarial audit. Company has, let us say, internal audit. Company might be having GST audit. Company has tax audit. Okay. Company may have, let us say, ISO audit, concurrent audit. So many kinds of audits company faces.
Are the cost auditors? Who are the cost auditors, sir?
Cost accountants. Okay. Just like statutory auditors are chartered accountants, so cost auditors can be cost audit. Cost accountants can be cost auditor. Similarly, company secretaries can be secretarial auditor. So like this. Internal auditors provisions are there. We have already covered that thing. Cost accountant or chartered accountant or any other professional can be an internal. Right. Now, friends, quickly we'll be understanding. Any query you have? This is one more aspect regarding audit report. Just now I explained you various types of audit report. Now, various processes involved in auditing. Very briefly, of course, I covered because it's a vast area. Very briefly, we'll learn. Before coming to these types of audit report, so I'll be telling you one more thing, that one of the duty of the auditor is to sign the audit. Audit report needs to be signed. Okay, auditor is supposed to put his signature in this audit report. And he has to mention his membership number. This is normally how the membership number, etc. are presented. Auditor has to write his name or his firm's name, his membership number, his firm's membership number, his own membership number, date and place. All these things should be there. This is again a requirement. How auditor should sign the report.
Sir, this is signed by you only, sir.
This is an example I am showing you.
Okay. Your
Sign seal with number.
Yeah, sign, seal, firm's registration number, auditor's own registration number, date and place, all these things should be there. Okay, so signature.
Sir, internal CA can be also an internal auditor, sir.
CA can also be an internal auditor.
Cost auditor or cost accountant or CA or company secretary. Anybody can.
Anybody can be internal auditor. Anybody can be the internal auditor.
Okay. But the statutory auditing only done by CA.
Only chartered accountants. Okay, so this is broadly I gave you some idea about how auditing happens, how auditors are appointed, how all these things we give you. That you know, also auditors' qualification and disqualification. What one more area is left out, that is various kinds of audit report. So we need to understand how to read the audit report, what are the contents of the audit report. That is also one more important area. If you look at any company's financial statement, if you download any company's annual report from their website, you can find the report consists of everything, like so many things like board of directors report, board report, financial statements, audit report, etc. We should have some idea about how to read audit reports. Audit report broadly is classified in these types. Audit report, in fact, contains an opinion of the auditor. Okay, today our time will not permit you to venture into in detail what kind of audit reports are issued, but briefly I will be telling you. Okay, audit report contains an audit opinion, and this opinion can be unmodified opinion. Unmodified opinion means we are talking about a kind of clean opinion. If auditor is satisfied with everything, he gives an unmodified opinion, means clean. Or modified opinion. That means not a clean opinion. Auditor has included something in his audit report. Okay. It can be of a qualified opinion. That means auditor is not satisfied with aspect to something. Or adverse opinion. Auditor is not entirely satisfied. Or disclaimer of opinion. Auditor is unable to give a clear opinion. Auditor doesn't have data or the company doesn't provide information. Therefore, auditor is unable to express his opinion. So we can classify these are the various types of reports which can be issued by the auditor. Okay. So what we'll do, so we'll plan to cover this kind of reports in our next class, which will be probably in tomorrow's class. But just have an idea that there is a possibility of this kind of audit reports can be issued. So tomorrow I'll be briefing you that how these reports looks like, what are the contents of this kind of reports. Okay. You got any query right now about auditing process, then
no, sir.
Please feel free to ask.
Tomorrow same time, sir?
Yeah, I plan to
cover the class.
Sunday. It will be better. Okay. I had a plan to cover it today, to finish it today. But you see, this is an important area. Within this 1 or 2 minutes, I don't think we'll be able to give justice to the subject. So purposefully, I'm leaving it for tomorrow's class. Tomorrow, we'll be discussing this kind of audit reports. Then maybe next to next class we'll be covering, we'll be entering into the new model.
Sir, in unit 3, we have just received volume 1 only, 3.1, 3.2, 3.3,
3.4. Don't worry at all, everything you'll be receiving. Thank you, we'll catch up. Everything I'll be sending you, don't worry. Okay, any point of time also, after the class, any point of time you ask, I'll be giving you. But once the module gets completed, it'll be easier for me to send you the slides.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sure, sir. No problem, sir. It's all yours. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good night, sir. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.